Thank you for coming on another snowy day. This is the second one we've had, and maybe by April we will have flowers and beautiful forsythia on the campus, and it'll be a whole different scene. But I always think it's a beautiful campus anyway.
Yes.
And quite unexpected out here on the flatlands of Kansas, right? All flat. I'm very pleased to present to you today one of our flatlanders, I believe from Kansas, Steve Shields, who most of you know. Steve has been working with older people for 40, 35 years, probably. I don't want to make you too old, but I think about 30, 35 years, in various roles in our state and elsewhere. Perhaps initially best known for his household model culture change implementation at Metal Arc Hills in Manhattan, which is a CCRC that doesn't look like a nursing home, is not set up that way. And Steve spent a long time making that work, and the one thing I will never forget about Metal Arc Hills is that it has more original Kansas artists on the walls than I've ever seen. And generally when I go to CCRCs, I don't see great art. I might see things that people like, but I don't see that authentic stuff. And I don't think Steve made Metal Arc Hills go broke over the art, but I think that Steve loved it, and I thought that was a fantastic way to engage in the life of Kansas in that particular unit. Since then, he has retired from that kind of work and is president and CEO of Action Pack, which he will tell you about. It's a full development firm, architectural firm, building quote-unquote retirement communities or intergenerational communities or health-centered communities for the future. And Steve is an excellent speaker, an inspirational individual, has big ideas, and I always think that the university needs people who are working out there in the real world. If this is not a real world with big ideas, sort of one foot in the real world and one foot in the dream world. And with that kind of dreaming, Steve, you will take us a long way. So welcome, and thanks for coming to the Boomer Futures Think Tank. It's good to see you again, sir.
Good to see you too. Mm-hmm. Good morning. I was trying to decide on the way over here what I would say today. Because there's more to share that I could possibly squeeze into an hour. When Dennis called and asked me to do this, he said, you know, people want to hear about your Liberty Project because it's an integrated project. It bridges the gap between acute care and post-acute care and living. It's intergenerational. The dependent care living aspect is organized to be on the terms of the people who live there versus them being subjected to institutional regimes. It invites seniors and non-seniors of a variety of different demographic and income-based origins to participate and live fully in the village concept. And so I understand people are interested in that, and I will talk about it. But one of the things I've learned in being an accidental disruptor in an international service sector is that most people want to just hear about what. And they don't ask why. They don't ask how. Because fundamentally, not to sound cynical, they fundamentally do not want to know. Because we come from wherever we come from, and we think in the way that we think. And we want to learn about the what of new things so we can apply how we think to it. in its own silo. And I want to talk a little bit about that because I think it's the cancer of our healthcare system. I think it's the cancer of our world, actually. So I'm going to recount a little bit of history, and I'm going to ask for you to bear with me on this because while I used to do keynote speaking all over the country and abroad about calling for change as part of this accidental role of being a disruptor, I don't really do much of that anymore, and I have no desire to. What I have a desire to do, which I did then, was to really make change on the ground. And I mistook our collective capacity for creating change through disseminating information and framework. I overestimated that access to that would actually result in broad-based change. And so I really made a decision about 5 years ago that I would go back on the ground and seek obscurity and just create difference with the people who are striving. Dennis and I were talking a little bit before, and Dennis, I hope you don't mind if I share this, but we were talking about our own aging. Dennis is 70, just about. I'm 57. Yesterday, when I got involved in this, I had a full head of hair, one chin, and was full of hope, and I'm still full of hope. But I was full of naivete about the way life is. And we were talking about the changes that we were feeling in our own aging. And I've come to understand why there are a lot of cranky old men. I really do. Because you spend your life trying to contribute. And you spend your life really thinking in the first three-fourths of that you're really going to make a huge difference. And that human nature can actually rise to be something more than what we see. And then you begin to get older and you begin to get a little more tired. And you realize that if you just make a dent, it's about all you're going to pull off. And that the challenge is don't get cranky about what that little dent was and keep your chin up. And I believe that, except I refuse to believe it. I refuse to believe that we collectively will actually choose personal temporary transactional comfort over deep, impactful change. And so that's what keeps me going. Now, I want to give you a little bit of history about this. And I want to say on the front end, my intent is not to make anybody uncomfortable, but that's another thing about getting a little bit older. Is, you know, the most important things are the things that we collectively decide we're not going to say. Those are the most important things. The realities that we're aware of that are under the surface that we don't speak to, those are the most important things. And I made a decision a number of years ago that I'm just going to say them. And the intent is not to offend. The intent is not to point, because most of those things I'm pointing right here. It's to have an impact. And then you can choose how you want to deal with that. One of the early, I want to give you a little bit of history about the Household Model because it is directly informative about any future models that emerge. It's directly responsible for this project. It's just moved several generations into the future with a broader scope. But it's where I have learned about what it takes to create integration. Integrated professions, integrated framework, integrated education, integrated teams, integrated living. And, you know, the Household Model, when we introduced that, the company of Action Pact introduced that, and it was really in its full integrated form, most fully expressed and communicated out of Metal Arc Hills in Manhattan, Kansas. And half of us have already forgotten about it because we have very short memories and we're always looking for the next thing. But in that particular case, it was a CCRC of good reputation. It had gone 12 years without a survey demerit. And so that was what elevated it. Except it doesn't mean a squatting thing. It was institutional. The floors were shiny. It didn't stink. Nursing care was solid. And there were a lot of people sitting around like this. You know what I'm talking about? Have you seen it? Okay. We're all directly responsible for that. And one of the things that I've learned about communicating and inspiring people, which is not my goal, or sharing with people, is, and I've gotten, I don't know how many directives on this as I get invited to keynote, is we want people to leave feeling good about themselves. So, okay, too bad. You might not leave here feeling good about yourself. That's because it's not my goal. My goal is for us to understand and begin to understand what the word integration means and how that needs to be applied on the ground and how it can routinely, dependably, repetitively produce transformed environments. And it's still escaping us. So the household model, when we introduced that in the late 90s, and then it started to become very publicly perceived and people wanted to know more about it in the early 2000s. You know, what was that? And why is it significant? When we think about how we age and how we end and work our way backwards, everything that we are scared to death of, everything we don't want to talk about, everything we push out on the edge of town, which coincidentally is where most of these places are. They're human warehouses. It isn't just that. That is the same in almost everything else. It's just that that's magnified because people can't go home. The impact, this is not age and disease. It is a complete outcome of people no longer having a voice in their own life, no longer having a purpose, no longer having a reason to get up and go to the bathroom. That's what produces that. And what keeps me on a plane every day, because I'm on a plane usually Monday through Friday, going from one place to the next, helping them transform, what gets me up every morning is that I know that when we're done in about 18 months with each place, they all come back. Every single frickin' time they come back. I had a researcher when I was sharing that say, "You've got to stop saying that, Steve. It hasn't been researched." Silo. It happens every time. So the lesson in this, and as whatever happens along this corridor expresses itself or doesn't, is what is it that brings people back? Most importantly, what is it that forces them down? Because they, none of them come in that way. Do you know what I'm talking about? Have you seen what I'm talking about?
Yes.
Okay, so what is it that pushed them down? And this was like a slow awakening for me. And the awakening of that is here, which I'll tell you about. But here's what it is. Did I offend you already?
No.
I love it when somebody has to get up and go to the bathroom. I just always try to embarrass them. Is, you know, what is it? What is it? And so I figured it out. We figured it out as a company. Is and I remember sitting at my mother's deathbed. This was in my waking. We had a $35 million project under construction, and it was being framed. And it was building more of the same. And my mother happened to be dying in the middle of that, which is the whole reason I got into this, because I came in out of the oil and gas sector in midlife. And on her deathbed, my father and I took 5 days off as the CEO of it because she was in my place, and sat at her bedside. And that was, those 5 days were the most informative, life-changing 5 days of my professional and personal life. Because I watched these people, and I knew everybody's name. I knew their families. I loved them all. I knew all the people that lived there. By all standards, I was like a good administrator because I knew the people. And I knew every person that worked there. And by the end of that 5 days, I hated them. I hated them. I had a fury because one would come in to do this and cross the other person coming in to do that. And that they were doing specific functions. I'm the nurse, you're the social worker, I'm the spiller, you're the picker-upper. And that's literally what would occur. And I didn't understand it, but I was pissed. And my mother, who never half-did anything in her life, did not half-do Alzheimer's. And so in the middle of the 17th year of Alzheimer's at age 74, she moved into active dying and didn't have to do that. She did the active dying to its complete potential. And I remember thinking, and we were exhausted, and I remember telling Dad, you've got to tell Mom it's okay to go. Well, she won't understand. You know, she hadn't known any of us for a decade. Dad, you've got to tell her. And I went out to the nurse's station, and I put my hand down. And my head down on my hands, and I went some. And I didn't hear, didn't think. I went somewhere. I don't know where it was. And I started to hear noises as I was coming. Help! Beep, 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 beep. Metal arc hills. And they all sounded foreign to me. And then I lifted my head up. And you know how you press your hands against your eyeballs, and things kind of get swirly? Is that just me, or do you guys get that?
Yes.
It's, you know, it was foggy and gray and swirly, and then things started to come into clarity, and I saw these people. Usually my mom was one of those, sitting there like that, and all these people were crossing each other in the halls, and it was like I'd never seen or heard any of it before. And I'd been the administrator there for almost 5 years, and it just... And I just thought, this is freaking crazy. This is wrong. I can't do this anymore. And it wasn't like, I'm going to quit. It was, I can't do this anymore. And I went back to Mom's room, and she died. And I don't remember her funeral. I gave the eulogy. I don't remember what I said. I vaguely remember my family coming. I just couldn't get it out of my head. This is wrong. There's something wrong. What is it? And I stopped construction. And that cost $1 million. And I almost got fired. And I didn't know what we were going to start back with. And that's not a smart thing to do. But I found a woman by the name of Lavrine Norton, who's now my business partner. Because I called every consultant I had ever heard of, because I knew in 2 weeks I had to know what we were doing, because every day was dollars. And so there were 17 consultants came, and I said, you're going to come, I'm going to pose my problem to you, and we're going to go around the table, and hopefully one of you remains. That's how desperate it was. And so I did it. And they came, and they were all wearing suits, except there was one woman, and she was carrying a bag, and she didn't dress like real fancy like the rest of them. And I thought, where did we find this one? And she sat on the end of the long conference table. And so I posed the problem. I said, we're under construction. We're building the wrong thing. We've got to do something different. What is it? And they all just kind of looked at me like, who's this nut? And so one guy stood up and he said, you need a paradigm shift. And I thought, sit down and shut up. I'm too busy for that. So next, I didn't say that, but that's how I felt. And so the next one stood up, and they were all similar murmurings until we got to that lady in the back on the very last chair. She told me later, she goes, after the third guy, I knew I had it. But she said, you need to put people back in the driver's seat of their own lives. You need to make sure there's home, no matter where they live, no matter what their needs are, you need to give it back to them. And I thought, I don't know what that means. I don't know how to do it, but that's it. So I said, thank you all for coming. Ms. Norton, will you please remain? And they all bumped out. And we sat down and hammered it out. You know, but what she had was the core of how do we organizationally behave and organize. And the rest of it came later, really. There were foggy notions of some of the other pieces, the finances, the real needs around the physical design, and all the other pieces. But that was enough. And within 2 weeks, we had redesigned everything and created these, what was named households. Now, here's the potency of it. Here's how it informs what we're doing. And I'm afraid for us because of the way we think and the way we allow others to behave and ourselves. Is the secret sauce of this, is at its core, how do we organizationally integrate? And here's what the deal is. You know, there's the nurse and the social worker, the spiller, the picker-upper, the regulator, the architect, the financial analyst. They're all in their silos. And we can all nod in agreement, except that it's what we do. And the antidote that, you know, we're number one in cost in health in this country, and we're 37th in outcomes. And we're not fundamentally dissatisfied with that. We're not fundamentally dissatisfied with that. And unfortunately, in our care models, void as they may be, we're not fundamentally dissatisfied with that. It's the pressure we're feeling that's making us move. It's not our commitment. And that, number one, is what's wrong with us. So it keeps us from actively seeking to eliminate the gap between the number one and the 37. And we're going to continue over the next 10 and 15 years to try and get around whatever's causing that pressure, just like we've done for the last 15 years on overcoming institutionalism. Everything about that journey is reflective of what we have ahead of us. And I'm going to be clear about this. These silos of self-interest, and it's not just money. It's silos of self-interest, whether that's social capital, whether it's I want to feel competent at all costs, I want to be viewed by my peers as this, I want to be safe, I am a consultant, I don't want my formula disrupted, bug off. Whatever they all are, they're squelching the life out of people. And the only reason we don't feel that way when we leave the doc, when we're at the doc's office, is because we get to go home. If we stayed in there, it'd be no different than the nursing home. If we stayed in the hospital, it'd be no different than the nursing home. So the premise is not only faulty, my belief is that it is immoral. It's immoral. So, here's the process. Once we did this and people started coming out, they started coming back. People got up when they want, they ate what they want, food was made in the kitchen. That sounds lovely, doesn't it? And it really was lovely, except internally. My first 3 years in this movement, while we were involved in the formation and the growth of the Pioneer Network, we were very involved with the state and federal government in changing regulations. I don't know how many trips I flew back and forth to Baltimore and sat down and helped write regulations. No matter how many times we were back and forth with the Life Safety Code people, which finally in 2012, the Life Safety Code has now changed to fit these new models. here's the deal. Me, who grew up in a very low approval household, you had to practically move the sun and the moon to get approval. My personality was I would lay down in the middle of the road for you to like me. That's my core personality. And accidentally, I became a disruptor of an entire industry. And so I learned that I had to set aside that need. And this is the key to getting out of silos, because we're every one of us in them. The key to getting out of that silo is to stop focusing on yourself and what your needs are. And that's why this thing's never going to go where it's supposed to, because we won't. We won't. So here's the traverse road, or here's the road we traversed once we established the model. Once you establish, and this is why I say, you can talk all day long, you can think all day long, you can write all day long, until you act. And many of us make entire careers of avoiding action. Until you act, it doesn't mean a damn thing. It doesn't mean a damn thing. It doesn't mean you shouldn't be thoughtful. It doesn't mean you shouldn't research. It doesn't mean you shouldn't do anything. But until you act, it doesn't mean a damn thing. And then once you act, then you, and it's a departure, you disrupt. And then the road that you travel from there, you better be brave. You better be brave. Because once you put yourself out there, and not you, but your message out there, the framework and the model out there, then you go through the steps when you're trying to just do the right thing. The way to actually change mindset is to create a framework that integrates it all together. And that in itself is the disruption. So you'll have the process of creating the integration, and it creates unbelievable beauty. It truly, truly, truly does. And it overcomes a lot of our other sins. Then you go through the step. And Lavrine Norton helped me articulate this in my own mind, because it was already articulated in hers, that institutionalism through organization of silos, stratified hierarchical silos, create an indoctrination of well-meaning people so that they become addicted to it. And so the process of changing that completely mirrors Prochaska's change theory. Are you familiar with it? Nobody even argues with it anymore. It's clear in overcoming addiction. The irritant, denial. You get the irritant, the call for change. Denial, anger. We would, but we don't know how. It's too expensive. And most of all, I don't want to change. I see how you should, and I can definitely see how you should, but I don't want to change. That's at the root of all this. So in the process in long-term care, when it's very clear, we made a decision that in creating this household model, which is really integration, the framework was we eliminate silos. Now, silos, what are they? You know, they're very myopic corridors in our organization and within ourselves of meeting self-interest. It might even be for a good reason, but it's meeting self-interest. And did anybody here go to Catholic school? Okay. Bless you, my job. I was raised and educated by the nuns, when they wore the big black habits. And I remember Sister Gabriel, who had one eye that went this way, and this is literally the truth, and one eye that went that way, and she had an arthritic finger. So she'd go, "You!" And there'd be like five of us standing up. We didn't know who she was talking to. But she would walk around and thumb her beads and talk about the stain of original sin on our souls. Did you all hear all that? Yeah. The stain of original sin is on your soul. And I remember thinking, what is that? And I pictured that it was a black stain on my lung or something. I couldn't get my head around it. But as I've gotten older, if in fact there is such a thing, and I don't know if there is or not, don't really care actually, but if there is such a thing, what is it that we all have? And it's that. It's everywhere. Silos, we have a need to differentiate ourselves, that somehow I'm better than you, and that we localize. And we have forgotten, we're losing our muscle memory even. We're losing our muscle memory because in our memories we're forgetting the wholeness of integrated thinking and the reality of integrated life. So the structure of creating these households and moving through an entire industry's stages of change has been how action-packed and those of us in it have spent the last 15 years. And I'm tired, and I'm sick of it, and it owns me, and I'm not stopping, because at the root of it, there's got to be hope that we can be better, and we've got a goal here, and we've got everything aligning around the fact that it's pressuring us as providers who are addicted to self-interest and chasing reimbursement and stratified siloed organizational structures that has resulted in what I think is a professional class dilemma of being so far removed from what really is that they don't even think in a way that we can relate to. I experience it every day. And an academic class who's become so siloed in pursuit of specific research and academic that they have lost their muscle memory of how we integrate this together and create wholeness. Am I getting too controversial and boring? Okay, so in this last number of years, as Action Pact has begun to reshape itself because we do organizational change work and we do architectural design for senior concerns. We do financial modeling. We source funds. We do executive coaching. We do operations. We manage facilities. And now we're building our own. And I'll tell you why we're building our own. Because we made a decision years ago not to brand this. We could have. Some could say we should have. We did not brand it. We gave it a name that was academic, shared and donated the framework to everyone. And the behavior around that, you better really know that you're doing that for the right reason because you're not going to get reinforced for it. Because as soon as you give it, you take it. And then you thought of it. And while you'll resent the giver for it, you'll be presenting on it at a conference within 30 days. It's the way we do. You understand what I'm saying? If you give, you won't be respected for it. If you trademark and build that, you'll be adored. So that's the way it is. So, but the reason we chose to do this is because it provides wider dissemination of change. And it has. That has moved primarily because of the contributions of Action Pact. It has moved nationally and internationally as mainstream thought with less than 5% true penetration in the marketplace. It's progress. It's why I'm going to be a cranky old man. Because it's there. We need to be at 100%. So several years ago, while we'll continue and always will doing third-party services in an integrated way, I've come across more projects we get called in on where there isn't a balanced understanding of the silos and how they need to integrate. So everybody calls the architect first and spends $1 million, $2 million, $3 million sometimes without all the rest of the pieces being articulated. Or they'll call in first. You can tell where the CEO is geared. They'll call in a financial modeler, and they'll give them a limitation based on invalid assumptions that your budget is X, which is usually about $15 million under what they should do, because the numbers guy wants to keep it low. They call the architect in, they design to that budget, and the programming process is disjointed. It's a mess, And it's why the facilities that we have look the way they do. And it's why they operate the way they do. And it's not just limited to long-term care or health. How many of you have been down in the Plaza? Okay. This came to me last time I was in Kansas City. And I was struggling with an investor who was investing about creating new realities. And they're really anchored in, they like it, but they'll only invest in what's done, even though they don't like what's done, because they'll get their 25% IRR, another silo. And it was down on the Plaza, and I got in the car and drove, and I was looking, because since we now have an architectural firm in our purview, I'm now much more sensitive to things I was oblivious to. And I was assessing the Plaza, because I was so pissed off from leaving that other meeting that I had to have a positive thought. So I was thinking, oh my gosh, this is a real successful sense of place. There was integrated thought and planning about, and this is going to lead us right into liberty. There was integrated thought and principles, not just architectural, but in every way that has made this thing, which was the first mixed-use retail development in the country in 1922, and it hasn't faded for 1 second. And it's very close to being 100 years old. All the principles are there. Think about that. And a deep, satisfying sense of place. You know, they even have the elevation on the outside and kind of the safe place with water running through it in the middle. It's all there, residential. It's all there. And it's sustaining. And it's 100 years old. So this isn't a new thought. We're losing our memory and our muscle memory. And I started driving out to our attorney's office at 119th and Knoll. And I drove as I began to leave the Plaza. And I got, I don't know, Kansas City like many of you might, but I got out into, I think, Prairie Village and Mission. And it was still nice, but it was less integrated in sense of place than the Plaza. And then I kept going out further, and it got uglier. And then I got out past 63rd, and it's absolute, complete, relentless pursuit of individual interests that do not in any way collectively come together to create place. Do you know what I'm talking about? That's present in everything we're doing in health. It's present in everything, and we're losing our memory. And it's number one in cost, 37th, and we've got to close that gap. And we're not going to do it at 119th and all. We're going to do it on the Plaza. And it makes me angry that we have hundreds and hundreds of years. Do you know why when we go to Europe, almost always, well, what'd you do? Well, we went to go see the cathedrals, right? That's what everybody's going to go see them, because they're majestic. And even if the worship of God is on the wane, the awe of the structure and what happens inside of it has sustained for 500 years. And I've thought to myself, why is that? Why is it? And I don't know that I know the whole answer, but here's what I do think it is. The master builder, which I'm not suggesting we need today, we need the integrated thought and application of the master builder in our integrated elements of operations and design. And we don't have it, which is why we have 119th and all. So we're going to do this thing. And it's going to be good. And I'm excited about it. Because, frankly, I'm worn out from almost 20 years of trying to give not control, share framework that's been demonstrated over and over, down to staffing structure, down to spatial relationships, down to degrees of privacy, down to leadership style, down to the team formation, down to each role without it being branded, and we'll give it to you. I'm done. You can take it. Go off and do it. I'm done putting all the eggs in the basket of making that available, and people going, well, we'll do this piece. And this, you read this in the Tipping Point, when you create deep change, there's language that emerges with it that is entirely reflective, and we're losing our ability to even internalize and absorb meaningful words. Because for us to realize the full meaning of them, we have to step outside of silos, our own, in order to understand the fullness of the word. But in deep change, deep language comes with it. And as things begin to move forward, and they begin to normalize out there, what happens, and the Tipping Point talks about it, stage two is mitigation. People pick iconic elements that are easy, that are showy, and they'll adopt the deep language and demonstrate. And until you move into it, ma'am, you might not be able to tell the difference between the two. Because artful organization of iconic elements, organizationally and physically, I'm done. So we're doing it ourselves. That way we can deal with our own funk. We're going to do it ourselves. We'll continue doing this work. But to have the impact, our strategy is here, and it begins here, but it's not going to stop there. I love this state. I could hardly wait to get out of it when I was growing up, and I never intended to come back to it. But my parents got sick, and my brother got sick, and they all died in environments, with the exception of my father. They died in environments that I'm ashamed of. I'm not only ashamed of myself, I'm ashamed of everybody. You too, that we collectively give permission to this. My father died a good death because he lived 8 years in a healthier household. He got what he wanted, did what he wanted, lived the life that he wanted, which isn't the life I would have chosen. I used to think I was adopted because he was the quietest, shyest man I ever met and never joined in anything, but he knew every aspect of what was going on around him. That was who he was, so he would sit over in this space, which fortunately we designed, because it's part of the integrated elements of the ability to be a part, but part of. You understand what I'm saying? There's a million things. So in this, we've integrated the organizational structure. We know how to do it. We know how to duplicate it. We know how to spread it beyond just the nursing home. The reason we started with the nursing home is because it was the most horrendous example of ourselves. So in order, you can't keep improving and hanging crystal chandeliers and building fitness centers and leave this there, which is what a lot of them are doing. You go to these nice places, but you better go look on the other side of the double doors, because this one flew over the cuckoo's nest back there. You know what I'm talking about? It had to be equalized so we could advance. And it's taken us 15 long years, because this was the deepest entrenchments. We've got a handle on it. We know how to do it. We know how to spread it through the continuum. And this will be the mothership. So now, the next step was, and I will say this even though we're on camera, we made a decision that we were going to create an organization that represented all the driving elements of the silos so that they would be integrated. That's why we bought a design firm. That's why we bought an architectural firm. That's why we have interior design. That's why we have organizational structures. That's why we source money. Because it keeps it balance, in Kansas City, because Kansas City was going to be where it was going to happen, and I didn't know which one it would be, and we got real close with another. But I will tell you this, when I talked about that professional class of removed reality, it's shocking. We have hospital clients in other states, it's shocking. It's shocking. The mindset of how that engineering is taking place to prepare for change. And up there, in fact, if I would have thought which of the hospitals in this metropolis will this find itself manifested? And I'm going to say this to the community of Liberty, Missouri. The last place on my mind, mainly because I didn't know that I thought we would have the breakthrough to create integrated health pursuit on a community-wide basis, Liberty. but it is liberty. And it ought to be liberty. Because as the city has grown in all directions and enveloped what were formerly small towns, and they've lost their identity to it, liberty is staunch. Liberty is liberty. And liberty has its own identity. And they have a persistence to feel obligation about creating and maintaining and protecting community and liberty. It's quite extraordinary. So, and they have a hospital who has a very forward-thinking executive team. They have a city government that is very forward-thinking. They have a populace who wants liberty to be successful, and they're anticipating the future. So there it is. So our relationship with them is one that we deeply value and we think has implications for others. And if it doesn't, that's fine too. Because what we know is going to happen is that liberty is going to be a healthy community, and it's going to age well. And they're going to be in the driver's seat of their community aging. So our strategy, and I'll be very open about this. I'm 57. You know, when you get to be 57, you start getting hints that you're not going to be around. You know what I mean? I think part of the whole problem we have all these self-protection and pursuit of stuff is people think they're never going to die or something. Or else why would you do it? Is we're going to die. And I'm not going to be functional at the level that I am for very much longer. I know it. I can even feel it. So I don't care if we share our entire strategy with anybody that walks and you want to beat us to it. Just don't mitigate it. And don't pick iconic elements. And don't be disintegrated. Steal it, but steal the whole damn thing. You hear me? So our strategy is we're going to create that. We have another project in Wyandotte County that will actually open prior to this one. It's just, we're just not releasing all the publicity on that yet. But our strategy is to create a mothership and we're going to move our way across Kansas. And we may move that way, and we may move that way. And it's not so we can grow to feed the monster. That's not it. It's that we think that it's within our capability, because we understand all the pieces and how to fold them together. We think it is entirely possible. And before I die, I want every standard nursing home gone. And I want them gone. And we're going to work our way as far west as we possibly can and create a blanket. Now, why is that important? Because this isn't just about nursing homes. And that's not just what we're talking about. But there's no integrated rural health strategy in this state, or really in any state, if you stop and think about it. We've all accepted that people are going to leave the small towns that have even projected. In the Department of Commerce, they've projected how many more ghost towns are going to be in Kansas by the year 2040. It's alarming. And we've accepted that the wealthiest, who are the oldest, when they have needs, are going to leave the town where they have a deep sense of place when they actually need it the most. We've accepted they're going to go to the city. And we're fine with that. Aren't we? I mean, aren't we fine with that? I'm not fine with that. Our company's not fine with that. So we're going to create a blanket. And we're just going to weave that blanket as far in those directions as we can responsibly every 30 minutes. Every 30 minutes. There's going to be a scaled around a local, very carefully chosen local community. And what that will do while we're all trying to get around Obamacare and all the things that we're doing to try to dismantle all the pieces, while everybody's trying to avoid that, we're going to create that fabric, because that means that nobody that lives between these is more than 15 minutes from anything. And technology, travel, we're going to create an integrated network. And I don't care if it becomes a not-for-profit after we get that. I don't care, but we're going to create that while everybody's resisting. And they're going to wake up one day, and it will be there. And it will have direct application to whatever's next. Does that make sense? Is this helpful?
Yes.
Is it?
It's a one.
Yes.
I just want to debate one point.
Oh, good.
To me. I don't think 57 or 56 is old, and I think you have many more years. And I think, and I think, just even looking around some of this room, you have a lot of youth, but you also have quite a few seniors that are interested in making changes and are risk takers. And I think that's one of the things that you're also pushing, is you have to take a risk to jump out and
do
something different.
What's your name?
I'm Judy Ballone, and you met me.
Oh, Judy!
Nooses, yeah.
How are you? You know what? Thank you for saying that, because I'll tell you, our customer base, they're strivers. That's who we're interested in. You talked about that earlier. Is you can think that what you're doing is for naught, because there's so many things that push against it, but in the end, what you do makes a difference for the strivers. And you all must be striving, or you wouldn't have gotten out and found a place to park here. There's some striving in you, or you wouldn't be here. And that's where change always comes from. It's where change mainstreams.
It's
where the early adopters are.
I just want to debate. It's not age-related, because you can still... And I see you, I bet you 20 years from now, you're going to be up here talking to us about some of the changes that you're seeing.
I know. You know why I'm thinking about it? Because, one, I still think I'm 23. I really do. It's just, and I don't even see myself being older than 23 when I look in the mirror. It's when I see photographs. I'm thinking, who is that old guy? You know, oh, that's me. You know, I'm aware of that. And it's not that, but I'm kind of, I don't think being old is negative. I just know that I have an increased awareness of my time is just more limited than it was. But the other reason I'm thinking about it is David Green, who was an early change agent that anyone in senior living knows. He made an impact, passed away yesterday. And we were all early in the movement. And there was not always the most comfortable relationship between the movement founders, but there was a deep bond. And so I'm aware that the early callers for change are now beginning to pass. And so it's in my head, so it just came out. Any other... Do you want to hear a little
yes,
bit about Liberty?
Yes.
When are you going to talk about Liberty?
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
Yeah, okay, that's why I came, so get on with it. Okay, all right. This is what we're calling a healthy living community. Everybody's going to find me. And so this is where I can start sounding intelligent. But here are the goals with this, is that... there are many gaps or silos that have to be conjoined. And we all understand that there's a gap between acute care and then whatever happens after that or before it. And so the interest of the hospital there and our interest is to enhance the operational integrity for the hospital through the introduction of post-acute continuum. And so the project will ensure sustainable quality of post-acute care for all the obvious reasons that we now are hearing about and talking about. Namely, reduce incidence of rehospitalization and exposure to the negative effects. People are talking about that, but it's amazing how few are really actually planning for it, and the impact of that is going to be significant. To enhance the financial performance through ancillary revenue streams. Enhance Liberty's visibility with clinical practitioners and consumers, and they have a fairly large network of physicians that are part of their system, and their cat canary goes clear up to the Iowa border. Enhance the hospital's brand equity and seize the opportunity to meet significant unmet market demand in the Northland. And there is significant market space up there that this project is going to pretty much eat up. Enhance the investment value of core assets through the physical integration of the main campus with new continuum campus. And this is really remarkable because those of us, you know, we all live in some sort of silos. And my job has been to try and understand enough about each of the silos that we know how we connect them. But most hospitals view expanding into that because they've all been buying physician practices or they've been investing in specializations and so forth. And it's an expensive venture. And so the hospital chose a partnership in this that provides a return on the investment and doesn't get into their cash. So that's a pretty smart thing. So the mission is to deliver a medically integrated, physician-driven, community-based model for wellness and prevention. Now that's the view from the hospital, and all this is going to integrate with the rest of the vision of the project. It's to promote and support personal health management, achieve measurable improvements and outcomes in not just the physical way, but in the spiritual, mental, and physical health, and provide an appropriate supported fitness and wellness period with the intent of ongoing sustainable self-directed regimen. In other words, this is creating a platform for active community involvement on achieving community health outcomes. So it's going to be a very supportive environment. It will connect inpatient and outpatient services and with not necessarily different people and provide evidence-based programs. And so it will effectively create a higher quality of life by building and supporting confidence, self-esteem, and self-worth. We all know about the traditional healthcare system. Almost half of us, even in our young 50s, have at least one chronic illness. We spend more, and more than 75% of health dollars is spent on people with chronic conditions. These persistent conditions leave in their wake deaths that could have been prevented, lifelong disability, reduced quality of life, and unbelievable healthcare costs in that last year of life. It's just astounding. So the gap in the traditional healthcare model, we need to we need to close the gap between the discharge from the hospital and the return to previous levels of activity. That we've got to compress that. And then what happens during that gap decides whether someone readmits to the hospital or can go a healthy way. So the purpose of this healthy living community is to engage through high participation. That's one of the action packed signatures, is that we gather all the stakeholders versus being done in a small room with the professional class, but involve everyone, the users, the frontline folks, everybody, in the process of creating not only the vision, but literally the size of the bathroom or whatever detail everybody's involved. So health reform is driving this. It shouldn't be, but it is. So it's moving from highly effective hospital to early integration and physician organization to full care continuum. So by having those three seamlessly integrated with everyone sharing incentives, the same incentives, then we create the ability to better manage patients with chronic disease and provide really good continuum services in a community-based setting and increase the ability for resources around individual health management and improve people's ability to manage their own health. So it's a partnership versus a make-or-buy strategy. So the traditional way is to focus on the physical and just treating symptoms that have presented themselves. We all know that. And usually we get 3 minutes with the doctor on that. And we have to traverse it. And anybody, why I don't understand this, when we've had a model, an integrated model at the acute level and at the physician level in Mayo Clinic, it's a good example of how we will refuse. So we make an anomaly out of them. So it's something that achieves kind of a superstar. And we've seen that with people, change advocates, whether it's Martin Luther King or whoever it is. It's that somehow they're different from us, and that's why they are, and we'll find ways to stay here. But we've had that down for almost 100 years too, and we haven't adapted it. So create a better integration in the treatment model while also focusing on the prevention of illness and disease. And it takes into account, and this Healthy Living Center will have components that reflect that. You can't just expect everybody to take that all into account because our original sin is we have our silo. And so there has to be present in the structure of the wellness of the Healthy Living Center the various components, including emotional, social, intellectual, spiritual, recreational, and others, so that the result is beyond the neutral point into long-term healthy living. Dr. Richard Reinhart, who, the first example of the Healthy Living Center is now stabilizing in Des Moines. And it's where it's different from us here, which is the second one, is that it is a standalone operation that has the relationship with the hospital, but there's no senior living or no focus on some of the other continuum areas. In Liberty, it will all fold together, not only with seniors, but in the broader population. He said, I've spent my whole career focused on diagnosing and caring for sick people, but not on how to keep them well. Now I have an option for that. And every physician is hungry for it. Once they get past their cynical silo, which is very present, and they're able to break through that. I was in, we were in Hartford, Connecticut last week dealing with a hospital board and physicians and the CEO. They had invited us up because they wanted to explore it. And we were talking about the different elements, including retail, that is not just sequestered for seniors so that there's a fake barbershop just for the old people, and a fake dining room or a fake restaurant that's just for the old people. I'm sick to death of that, and I don't want to live in it, even though I've managed one, neither do you. And we all know it. So we were talking about a two-faced barbershop, for example, of retail, that you're just as likely to see a kindergartner in the chair next to you are where you're getting your haircut, because it's integrated. And the doctor said, I don't care about barbershops. I only care that my patients are going to be able to get the... And I thought, well, I know that. I know that. That's our problem, is nobody cares about the whole, they just care about their piece. Do you know what I'm saying? And this physician, there's a growing number of physicians, and the physicians who are part of this Liberty Project, because part of the ability to even make this able to be announced and now formally move into design is all of the engagement of the stakeholders, and the physicians are very excited about this. So, the focus is on restoration and prevention, taking the expertise of both medical and fitness professionals and developing a team approach. So in this, there's the primary care physicians and health coaches, senior service organizations, corporate health services, because up in the Northland there, Hallmark, Ford, there's thousands of employees up there that they currently don't have easily accessed health and fitness services for corporates. YMCA members, and that's true up in Des Moines, it won't be here. The hospital, employee benefit design and health plans, so the hospital employees can all be part of this, and the specialty physician clinics. So, I'm going to talk about the Healthy Living Center. It's the cornerstone of the future medical campus. It's the cornerstone of the future integrated campus. It's a cornerstone of a community wellness model. And it allows us to seamlessly integrate our clinical care expertise with fitness activities, education, and support services to help people. So you all can have access to this. We'll be glad to give you. I'm not going to walk you through all of it. But basically, it's just all the things that you would feel and think and want in terms of what's going to drive us. We're going to create elder health and wellness system that transforms, age from being viewed as a disease. The Department of Age and Disabilities. Like, does that just ring a little odd to you guys? The Department of Age and Disabilities. You know, don't get me started. But age isn't a disease. Age is an achievement. It's an achievement. And if you're sick and old, that means you're sick. If you're sick and young, that means you're sick and young. But age and youth, neither one of those are diseases, right? We automatically don't think youth is a disease. Why do we think age is a disease?
Individual within the context of their life pursuits. And there's a 100 different ways I could get off on any one of them about keeping people vibrantly connected to themselves and to the people and the places and the things that have meaning to them so that they can do their own translation of their degree of acceptable fitness and their degree of emotional wellness, etc. Do you understand what I'm saying? So the big thing was to create an integrated model that's financially viable, and this is a very financially viable model. It's very exciting. Now, and I'm not going to go into this on the household model, except I'm going to say this, that if you are in senior living, or you're going to create anything that moves us to the next level, if you have not addressed your institutional facilities or elements, it's a noose around your neck. If you're building a new one and you are not truly maximizing on the knowledge and the resources to create an environment where people truly, not iconically, have good living up through death, there's going to be a noose around the rest of your project. There's going to be a noose, and there is a noose, around your existing campus. And so that anything that you do that feels sexy, and really until now nobody gave two hoots about old. That's why they were on the edge of town. It's why they were human warehouses. The reason everybody's getting interested in it now is because the boomers have been in control a long time, and all of a sudden we're starting to think, it's okay for mom, but not for me. And the second thing is, the number of boomers, there's money. And I'm seeing developers that, this is the scary thing, man. Now everybody and their dog in the development world is wanting this, and they really don't care about how it's going to live. They just want their formula met. And there's a lot of people feeding into that. So this thing has the potential to go, this next 10, 15 years have potential to go to some pretty dangerous places because of the lack of integration and balanced integration. So the household model, you have to really understand what those elements are, and they have to be built into your program. And they will all be there at Liberty. So within that is independent living, assisted living, assisted living, memory support, short-term stay, rehabilitation, long-term care, skilled nursing, and the Healthy Living Center, Senior Living Community Center, and retail. And also, people of all ages. This particular piece, because we didn't redo this, it was aimed at people who were interested in senior living. They're solid. So, in this is going to be intergenerational living opportunities. So, both for people who work there, and people who live in the broader community of Liberty. So this is the master plan. This thing will have multiple phases. The hospital sits right here. And so the main entrance to come in and experience this will be, the front entrance for the town will be the Healthy Living Center. And that Healthy Living Center is the conduit for engaging the community. It also, and regard, you know, that's the thing. I'm not even going to get into whether we like the master plan or like the layout or, you know, we won't even get into that. But conceptually, and the buildings won't look anything like this. This is like an early master plan version of it. There's going to be a lot more. See where you see row houses, there's row houses in here. There's going to be a lot more. This is going to be a pedestrian community. But here's the deal.
What's the professional housing?
That's going to be for employees and also a specialist who may be there and maybe on call for a period of time. But that actually, I don't want to sound. In order to engage each group, you have to point it. You have to have different things pointing so it meets their interest. That's how we've been able to do this.
That's not residential housing.
There's going to be residential housing.
It's called professional housing?
there's going to be a floor, or a partial floor that's professional housing. But there will be different housing available, and it'll be sprinkled in different places around this campus so that it's truly integrated. So this is why I don't like to show pictures, because people will zero in on a specific thing. It's but here's the concept here on this Healthy Living Center. What is going to integrate the senior living element of it is that it will not have separate community spaces just for the seniors. Well, the household models will each have their own living, dining, kitchen, and the food will be made there, and they can have the privacy of their own collective home and an apartment within that home, so there's home within a home. The retail spaces and the common wellness space, there will be three swimming pools of different sizes inside of here. But the barbershop, the restaurants, the yoga, all the other different things that will happen in there will be serving all populations, from people who live here and who also live in broader Liberty, so that you don't have the violin playing, gracious napkins, senior living sequestered together, that it is fully integrated with all ages. Plans also include here active elements of families of different ages that would live here, but also programs within that Healthy Living Center. While this won't be a swim gym kind of fitness center, you know, we want to have, for example, a kindergarten and different things that will have children part of this piece on the Healthy Living Center with intergenerational housing here. This is the opposite entrance to the campus, so that there are two different orientations of experiencing the village. There's the hospital acute and the segue of the Healthy Living Center. And remember that this is an urban environment. If you drive up there, the context of the urban reality of that area drives the urban development. So if a person wants something more pastoral or rural, then that means that, you know, that will fit that setting and market. Any questions about, any questions?
It's like it would make it easy for someone who's in their maybe 60s or 70s or whatever to go volunteer in the kindergarten, or, you know, just, that's going to be a lot more interesting.
Yeah. And I think that'll be a given. Yeah, absolutely. Yes.
We included schools and churches within a geographic.
Yes, we're taking inventory of the church memberships. That's something, again, this that we're showing you was the engagement tool for the acute and physician community, right? It's taking new shape as we bring in the community itself. And so that's why I hesitate to even show you pictures. People love to see eye candy. But then as soon as they see it, then they, you know, then it's literal. Well, that's what they're talking about. I don't like that. You know what I'm saying? But the methodology of engagement is we're now bringing in the city. They're very excited about it. We're going to bring in residents. Now, we're not going to try and make a sequestered community either. So every component of a town, it's in migration and out migration. And so we don't want to create a sequestered integrated. You see what I'm saying? When there is a town of liberty that all that needs to stay interconnected in and out. Any other questions or thoughts? Has this been helpful?
Yeah. What's the timeline on this?
We're starting design. All the board approvals have now taken place, and now we're finalizing all the operating agreements, et cetera, et cetera. And the sizing and scoping and design is March. And so I think we're thinking about spring, early summer of 2016. Isn't that correct? Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, I wanted to get back to your plaza.
How are you?
Because I read a book about race relations in America recently, where a big chunk of the book was on J.C. Nichols and the plaza and the suburbanization of Kansas City, and how that whole effort really led to white flight and decimated like parts of Eastern Troops and things like that, okay? And so it seems like if you don't take a systems approach build something new, you can really create problems, maybe that you haven't been thinking about. And so I'm wondering...
Oh, that's so right.
So I'm wondering with what you're talking about here, how will I have the rest of liberty, you know, existing things,
yeah.
existing
and you know, the biggest thing about trying to create integrated realities is trying to be awake. That's my worst fear, you know, not being awake to something. Is what are the unintended consequences, you know? There's always a rub of creating new and being considered the old, and that's just a classic struggle that has not been handled well, generally speaking. That's like eminent domain. It's just like it's an ugly way of creating new reality. So one of the things here is that this is all burning land. Nothing's being taken out that displaces people. So everything that's coming into this are amenities and options that were not presently available. And they are, and there's a broad range of ability to participate at a variety of different levels by people of different socio and economic backgrounds. So membership as from the broader community is going to be very, very affordable. The intergenerational living will take very much into consideration deep market study that identifies age and income realities so that we know how to architect the intergenerational living. The senior housing in relation to dependent models or semi-dependent models, we already know how to create this really vibrant living environment at a cost-neutral, cost-savings outcome. So that we know will come in. And then the independent housing for those who are of age will have to build diversification of product. Now, here's the challenge with that, because everybody's siloed. Section 41 housing has rules about how many can have money, how many can't. A lot of federal programs want to just have all poor people. And, you know, it's like we create these different. So navigating that has its challenges. But our intent and desire is to create accessibility for the entire community. All new options that weren't presently available.
Steve, we're at 1 o'clock, so I know people probably have to go, but you're going to be here a little longer, I know. So I wanted to thank you very much for your presentation.
You'd be a good guy. You know, this guy's done a lot of freaking work for nothing for a lot of other people's benefit.
Thank you. You can see this on our website again. And if you want to stay longer and talk to Steve, he's here. We are happy to have him. Thanks a lot.
It's just, I riveted it.